Hello, namaste, and welcome to Delhi. I'm Divina Gupta, and this is Work Life India on the BBC, the show that looks at all things to do with money, the work we do, and the lives we lead. Now, imagine a world where you don't have to deal with a banker to manage your money. Imagine a currency that is not issued by a government, but is actually just a series of digital codes. This is the new world of cryptocurrencies. From Bitcoin to Ethereum, there are over 2,000 cryptocurrencies around the world. But India views cryptocurrencies with suspicion. It has placed restrictions on their trade, and now a ban has been proposed. So we're asking, should India ban cryptocurrencies completely? Cryptocurrencies worth over $300 billion are in circulation around the world. Some global investors believe they are the new digital gold. Now, large corporations like Facebook are trying to bring their own cryptocurrency. So is this an opportunity that India is missing out on? To discuss all this, we have with us today Ashish Agarwal, who's Senior Director and Policy Head with NASSCOM, which is India's leading IT body. Welcome, Ashish.
Hello, Divna. Glad to be here.
And Ashish, I wanted to ask you, is it right to say that India has effectively banned cryptocurrency?
See, central bankers globally and states are concerned about cryptocurrencies, and India is no different. So, as you know, RBI last year, the central bank here, effectively made it very difficult for entities and consumers to participate in cryptocurrency transactions. And now what we have is a government report which is actually recommending that the cryptocurrencies should be banned. So I guess that's the direction we are headed, but there is a discussion ahead that I think will happen.
And you've met a lot of government officials on that one, so I want to get all the inside details from you, Ashish. Glad to have you. Akruti Gaur is also with us. She's a lawyer and specializes in cryptocurrency and other technology sector. Tell me, Akruti, honestly, have you dabbled in cryptocurrency?
Well, I have. I happen to own a couple of cryptocurrencies, Ethereum to be precise, but that's outside the country. So I think I'm safe for now.
You're safe for now, and your $200, if I'm not wrong, are
absolutely
safe. Priyanka Sharma, she's a young 27-year-old chief of staff, Buzzyrex, which is a cryptocurrency exchange. Business is good, Priyanka?
Yes, it is, Devina.
Despite of all
asking.
The uncertainty?
yes, it is. Because we are seeing people's interest in cryptocurrencies rise with every day, and more people are getting aware of what the cryptocurrencies are, and the impact it can have on the economy. So yes, I think it's a good time.
So in India, where you actually can't buy or sell using a banking as a financial institution to deposit your money, it's actually exchanges like yours which are playing a key role, because what you do is a peer-to-peer transaction.
Yes,
is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And why is it so much interest? Why is there so much interest in cryptocurrency still?
See, because one, the first thing that comes to my mind is because of the crazy return on money that you get. That's one. And second, the beauty of cryptocurrency is that it's a digital currency that is not restricted by the geographical boundaries today. So whether I want to send a crypto from Mumbai to Agra or Mumbai to London, it won't change hands. It'll just, you know, it'll happen at a lightning speed.
And it's a technology called blockchain through which it happens.
Yes.
In nanoseconds, if you may. And Ashish, that's a technology that India is very keen to adopt. Well, when you interact with government officials on cryptocurrency, what are their concerns?
So like any industry, I mean, we have seen technology disrupt the transport sector, the hotel industry. In this case, technology is actually disrupting a very fundamental thing which has been run by the government for ages. It's disrupting the market for money, and government rightly is concerned. So that's one. Second is the consumer protection aspect. I mean, if you look at it in India, the awareness and knowledge about cryptocurrencies, one can assume that it's such low, and the chances of Ponzi scheme, and we have heard those cases, consumers getting cheated, is very high. So from a government perspective, these are larger concerns. And in some sense, from their perspective, potentially thinking restricting or banning it, maybe they think that's the way forward.
They feel that that's the way forward. Well, Akriti, when you invested in cryptocurrency, and as Ashish pointed out, that it is a new technology, which is not that much understood by a lot of officials. Priyanka said there are crazy returns. For you, was it, honestly, fear of missing out, which is called FOMO for millennials, or was it looking at the fundamentals that there is an asset class which has strong fundamentals where I can invest in?
It was a mix of both, to be very honest, and started with FOMO, as we call it. But I think also reading about it, looking at, you know, friends or family and everyone who's been investing and, you know, getting crazy returns and reading about the Bitcoin fluctuation and people who invested 20 years ago are like actual millionaires, if not billionaires. It felt like a modern asset to be investing in. So,
and that's when you decided to take the plunge. Now, the panel of formed by the Indian government to look into cryptocurrency, one of the points that it mentions, Priyanka, is cryptocurrencies have been created by private enterprises, do not reflect the sovereign guarantee of value that are distinguishable from a regular currency. So, say a note, a dollar bill, or a rupee note actually has a signature of the bank's governor. There's a guarantee by the country for it. Cryptocurrency is seen as having no central bank, no authority, which is also its weakness at a time when people don't want to trust it.
See, crypto, it's a little unfair to pit cryptocurrencies against fiat currencies like US dollar or euros. And it's not, I understand it's not backed by a sovereign identity, and that's why it is decentralized. That's why cryptocurrencies are decentralized. And this is why it brings power, like it gives power to the people. And yes, I mean, that's something, I think that's a very, like that's a huge strength of Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies.
Have you been able to use your cryptocurrency investment outside India? And have you been able to use it freely?
Well, I haven't had the chance to go out of India, and I haven't been, like, I haven't been able to use it. But there are plenty of platforms that are using Bitcoin as a payment, and they are very conventional platforms, which are very famous, and they accept Bitcoin as a payment.
So there are restaurants in some countries.
Yes.
There are certain websites.
There are travel desks that accept Bitcoin as payment.
Right.
And recently, one started accepting Ether as well.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Ashish, I want to ask you this. Countries like Singapore are planning to do away with sales tax if the consumers want to spend cryptocurrency, essentially asking them to spend in bitcoins and the other cryptocurrencies. There are countries like Japan where it is completely legal. Is India missing out on this trend?
So Devina, the jury is still out on this. I mean, the UK's Financial Conduct Authority has just said that it is considering banning for retail use. In US, we are having committee hearings which are saying and discussing every day that should we ban them or not. So in that sense, it's not, it's an evolving stage, but if you take a step back, the technology itself, it's very evolving. I might say in hindsight, 20 years back, we look up and say that it was a very clunky stage in 2019. So we need to think about innovation going forward. And also from a point of view of micropayments, I think a lot of stuff which we are seeing currently might be gimmick and the technology.
Why do you say that?
Because to do a micropayment in a Bitcoin, frankly, it doesn't make sense, because when you do that, if you compare the transaction cost, when you compare the ease of doing it, at least in a domestic scenario, it doesn't make sense. There are cross-border scenarios where obviously it beats the cross-border traditional money payment systems. But then overall, when you look at this, this is something, again, which will evolve over a period of time. So people today might be treating it as an asset class and investing, and there is a speculative element, and that's one use case. But then going forward, these use cases will evolve. After all, it's just a form of a token.
But what if there are corporations like the US-owned Facebook that comes into play, which wants to have Libra as a cryptocurrency backed by 20 odd investors, which should be accepted because it's backed by investors like Uber and Visa, where you do these transactions? Do you see the scenario changing, Akriti?
So definitely, Devina, there are some concerns and some benefits that, you know, Libra proposes to have. They released their white paper recently, and they plan to mainstream Libra in a lot of countries. There are two aspects to Libra. One is a Libra coin, which will be your cryptocurrency for daily transaction, and then there's a Libra investment token. So we see a similar sort of trend in the form of, you know, a crypto-backed asset and an actual cryptocurrency that Libra seeks to achieve. But I also feel like definitely concerns of fluctuation might be addressed with Libra, considering that it's backed by a consortium of corporations which have, you know, wide representation globally, and at the same time it is linked to a bunch of legal tender, which is a fiat currency actually, which is a US dollar, which is I think the British pound and two more currencies. So in a sense it is poised to be stable coin, and stable coin is something which is more stable rather than Bitcoin, which is of course prone to more fluctuation. So some concerns around fluctuations will be.
But do you agree with this? Do you agree with this, Ashish, that Libra, when it comes into the market, right now Facebook in its latest quarterly report has said it may not meet the 2020 guideline. It's still working around the regulations so that there is no trust deficit there, versus the other consortium of cryptocurrency, including Bitcoin, which essentially we still don't know who is behind the pseudonym of Sakoto, and also the other cryptocurrencies.
So, Devina, the concern changes. There are certain kind of concerns in a Bitcoin. For example, there is no issuer. Now, in Facebook case, for example, there is an issuer, and there can be other concerns. But essentially, the point is this. This is technology. You have laws to regulate investments. You have laws to regulate the payment systems. And essentially, if these are the two use cases we are talking about, that's the legal structure that already exists. Now, the challenge is that traditionally, the way these legal and regulatory structures have developed, they don't necessarily automatically fit into this new asset class. So that's a challenge for the regulators to figure out.
I also see another challenge, and Priyanka, you must have seen this as well, because India is a cash-based economy. 80% of our transactions are done in cash. If I go to my father and say, do you want to use a debit or credit card for a transaction? He suddenly will not do it and will tell me 10 reasons why he doesn't trust it, because there is a perception against the digital money. For Libras of the world, will it be an easy road, even if the regulations are changed?
I think it will be a really easy road, Devina, because I completely agree that most of the rural India is unbanked today, and they have no access to banks. And tomorrow, but the funny thing is that most of these rural places, they have mobile phones, they have 4G internet. So, and all, I'm sure pretty much all of them have Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, which all of three of them are Facebook products. So when, if and when Facebook launches Libra coin, they are going to be one of the first people who will adopt it, because it's very tough to set a brick and mortar bank there. So the only way they can get access to digital, they can be a part of this digital revolution is by, and Libra is going to be their way in.
So awareness is what's needed.
Yes.
And adaptability, you say, could be there. Well, this is interesting, because in December 2017, that's the time when cryptocurrency was still legal in India. So to say that you could buy, sell or trade. I know, Priyanka, you have other view on that, and I will take
it's
you.
It's legal.
Yes.
It is still legal.
But you can't go through the banks to deposit your money.
But the truth being told, Reserve Bank of India does not have the legislative. The Central Bank of India does not have the legislative power to ban anything, right? The power is solely vested with the government of India, and they have yet to decide, like they have yet to take a stand on it. So let's call it legal, please.
You know, I always remember when there's a clever marketeer on the panel, read the fine print. But I want to actually take you through this short clip that we did earlier in the day. In December 2017, when Bitcoin touched a high of $20,000, its trade was legal in India. Entrepreneurs Prashant Sharma and Niti Shree were getting married then in Bengaluru. So when I say legal, it means that you could take Bitcoin, deposit it in your bank as well, or exchanges which had digital wallets at that time against rupees. Also known as India Silicon Valley, in Bengaluru, they decided to ask their guests for a Bitcoin as a wedding gift and made headlines because they were called India's Bitcoin couple. I spoke to them earlier and began by asking, what was the reason behind this decision?
We were just having a discussion, Neeti and I, whenever we used to go for any marriages, and a lot of our friends got married during that year. And whenever we used to go, the biggest headache which we used to have was what to gift. And both of us started thinking that if that is our interest, and if most people who's coming to our marriage are our friends, then how do we marry these two things, which is technology, future, and gifting? And then suddenly it struck us that, okay, why not Bitcoin?
But tell me, what were the preparations that you made? Were guests asked to get a Bitcoin with them and a code with them? What did you do at that time?
So in our invitation card, we had our Bitcoin address, and we had partnered with ZepPay, which was then India's leading Bitcoin exchange. So there were instructions in the invitation card itself on how can you own your first Bitcoin and gift us.
And also the bar had all the menu in the bar were themed on cryptocurrency, not necessarily only Bitcoin, but the other cryptocurrencies.
Yeah, so it was it was actually for creating awareness that there's just not Bitcoin. You have other cryptocurrencies as well. And that's why we had drinks named on different cryptocurrencies. I think Ethereum was the most popular drink during our wedding.
Well, Neeti, tell me something, because in India, the concept of gold and gifting gold to daughters during marriage is very much prevalent. And the idea is that it helps you in your rainy days. Gold is seen as a saving instrument in India. Were you able to change perceptions?
So I think those times in media, even in, so I belong to a place called Patna. So where, you know, you can imagine technology has not benefited that much. But because of these stories, so people were comparing Bitcoin to gold that time. Like my mom was telling that, you know, I'm giving you some money, why don't you invest my money also in Bitcoin? So, yeah. And even his dad, so he comes from Jamshedpur, and even he was willing to do that. So I think, yeah, we were able to do that time.
And how many Bitcoins did you manage to get from your guests?
How many Bitcoins is a big question. But the fact remains that, yes, we did get 1 lakh worth of Bitcoins. At that point, Bitcoin was trading at $20,000. So you can do the maths.
So it was around $1,500 is what I've read that you guys were able to get for your wedding. And you're right, because December at that time, Bitcoin actually touched its all-time high of $20,000. But the next year, there was a crash. So it was a high that you experienced, then the low. Did you plan to sell it out then?
We have not sold it. We have just kept it. It is just there. Because that was something that we didn't do, right? Like the guests gifted us, and there is no point in selling a gift.
But Neeti, now even there is a plan from the government. An Indian panel has said that holding Bitcoins and other cryptocurrency will be punishable by 10 years. And then there is a financial penalty as well. So do you guys have a plan of what to do next if that bill comes and becomes a law?
So frankly speaking, we don't have any plans as such. And I told my mom, your money is gone, so don't really think about it.
Well, that really hurts, Akriti. You know, you have money locked and you can't use it. But there is an uncertainty, as we were discussing earlier with Priyanka, which is right now in India. What happens in other countries? How is it that we are able to see other countries adopting more consumer-friendly, if I can use that word, regulations?
Absolutely, Devana. There are so many countries which have taken the route of not completely banning cryptocurrency for sure, but they're making their use or their storage legal through a lot of other measures. So for instance, you have Japan, which has made crypto assets legal, or you have the case of the US, which has a three-pronged approach to some of the cryptocurrency regulation, which overlaps. So in certain cases, cryptocurrency is treated as a commodity. In certain cases, you know, where you're investing it through initial coin offerings, it's treated as security. And in certain cases, it's being treated as digital property or property for the purpose of taxation. So, you know, all of the problems which can potentially arise from mainstreaming cryptocurrency use, which is fraudulent transactions, defrauding investors, terror financing, money laundering. There are so many existing examples of, you know, potential or actual regulation in EU, US, you know, China, Japan, and so many other countries, which can be considered by India.
In fact, Priyanka, when we were earlier talking, you mentioned that how the Financial Action Task Force has actually now started giving guidelines how to regulate cryptocurrency so that the anonymous usage, which has been a concern for many economists that it may be diverted for terror funding or illegal activities, is being controlled. What's being done about it?
So, first, again, I would like to say this. This terror funding or money laundering, this is very prevalent even with fiat money that's circulating today. Mm-hmm. So whether it's US dollars or Indian rupees, people with malicious intent, they do manage to do money laundering and everything. And tomorrow, if the government decides to bring in proper AML and KYC guidelines,
which is know your customer. But I also must add the anonymity of the transactions. And this is the word from Joseph Stiglitz, a Nobel Prize winning economist, who says cryptocurrency should be shut down. He worries that they enable illicit activity by making money transactions less transparent.
I disagree with this person. And see, the thing is, so if to combat terror financing, so what government can do is when you take, you can always work with the cryptocurrency exchanges because and make them more KYC compliant and anti-money laundering compliant. And then, of course, because Bitcoin blockchain is a public ledger where you can see all the transactions that have happened. That's what it's a public ledger. So you can see all the money where it has gone and you can track 99, like all the transactions that have happened.
But if it's so secure, and this is a question to you, Ashish, why is it that we've seen scams like Mt. Gox in Japan, where almost 650,000 Bitcoins in 2014, when it shut down after almost 3 years of operation, were disappeared and they claimed it was stolen. The investigations are still on and there were thousands of investors who were left without a single penny almost overnight.
So Devina, that's where I think we need to be very clear that it is not the blockchain which is compromised.
Mm-hmm.
It is the wallets which can get compromised. It is the exchanges which can have problems. And that's true for a lot of things. I mean, you can have similar or worse cases in traditional fiat currency and the banking industry. And we have had ATM frauds. We have different kinds of fraud. So that doesn't take away from the fact that this is a revolutionary technology. It eliminates the third party by its very design. And it, what actually it does is it allows payments to happen seamlessly. It is already, we can see the differences in terms of cross-border payments and potentially going forward with, let's say, the Lightning Network coming up in the next few years and a lot of other iterations of cryptocurrencies. It can also make the micropayments a reality. Now, from a government perspective, they have a concern. And those concerns, as we said, can be addressed by regulation. And that's the moment we need to...
There's another proposal which the panel has, which is that India's central bank could have its own cryptocurrency. We've seen this being done in Venezuela, where Maduro government has started petro, which is hedged against their oil reserves. And it's now directing banks to use it to circumvent the economic sanctions. In India, in a country which is one of a brighter spot in the Asian economy right now, Akriti, do you believe the currency that a central bank comes out with, which is a digital currency, could perhaps be the middle path?
So, Devina, I have one point, as in our country is the brightest, but it's also a country of a billion people. So what confuses me is that even if we were to come up with a digital currency of our own, which is the digital rupee, the way in which it is going to be mainstreamed, right, whether India has the technological architecture to implement it or whether this digital currency will be routed through the central bank or through existing banks, which means will it actually include the unbanked? So there are so many questions with this proposal which are unanswered.
Okay, I'll have to leave it at that. But there are solutions which are trying to be worked out. None of them are perfect at the moment. But like any investment, cryptocurrencies are also subject to market risks. While it's difficult to resist the temptation to make a fast buck, trading in cryptocurrency is certainly not for the weak-hearted. Thank you so much for joining us. Do tweet on hashtag WorkLifeIndia. And you can also write to us on Delhi_WorkLifeIndia@bbc.co.uk.